Hi, I'm John Iredale, Pro Vice-Chancellor here at the University of Bristol. Welcome to the next in our series of Fireside Chats podcasts, in which we're exploring the way in which the university and its staff have contributed to the effort to tackle this COVID pandemic that we're all facing. Now, mathematical modelling, we've been told repeatedly, lies at the heart of the epidemiology and the planning that informs government policy. So why is mathematical modelling so important? Why does it hold such a great place in the way in which we plan for dealing with the pandemic and making decisions such as when lockdown would occur? And one of the key components of mathematical modelling, of course, is the now oft-quoted R number that has even found its way into the tabloids. So what exactly is the R number? What does it mean, and why should we all be interested in it? So to help me answer these questions, it's an enormous pleasure to welcome today Dr. Ellen Brooks Pollock, who's based at the Vet School. Ellen is a senior lecturer in veterinary public health, and she's associated with the Health Protection Research Unit in the medical school. She is a mathematical modeler and thus perfectly placed to assist us with these questions and tell us about her work. She advises SAGE via a subgroup, the Scientific Pandemic Influenza Group, which have been modelling disease outbreaks. And she is also advising the SAGE subgroup on children. Ellen's work also contributes to the local models that are used to understand how the pandemic is playing out in the Southwest. So Ellen, you are very welcome.
Thanks, John. I'm very happy to be here to talk to you about modelling.
Excellent. Right. So probably a good place to kick off is, could you just tell us a little bit about your background and about mathematical modelling, and then I'll move on to asking you what the R number is.
All right. Well, I might cover that anyway. So my background is, I actually went to university to study medicine, and then I swapped and finished doing a maths degree. After that, I did a PhD in infectious disease modelling at the University of Warwick with Matt Keeling. And so I've been doing infectious disease modelling ever since, really, in various different places. So mathematical modelling, it's about quantifying the spread of an infectious disease mathematically. And you do that by assigning specific values and probabilities to the processes involved in infection and transmission. So, oh, you said you'll ask me about the R number, but I'll bring it up already. So there's two essential quantities that you need to know in order to describe the spread of an infectious disease mathematically. And they are the reproduction number, which has now been termed the R number, which is the number of secondary cases produced by an average case. So for coronavirus, in the absence of any control, so before lockdown, that's about 3. So for every 1 coronavirus case, they would go on to infect 3 other cases that would then show up as 3 other people that would show up as cases. And that's the reason why the reproduction number is so important, is it tells you how easy it is to control an infectious disease. So the reproduction number for flu, for example, is about 1. So each case produces 1 secondary case. For things like measles, the reproduction number is between 16 and 18. So for every 1 child that has measles, they go on to infect 16 to 18 other children who then have measles. So this is the one thing that's important. The reproduction number is the first important quantity. And the second is the serial interval, which is the time between successive cases. So for coronavirus, again, that's about 1 week. So if I'm diagnosed with coronavirus today and I infect you, you'll be diagnosed next Tuesday. And those two quantities, the reproduction number and the serial interval, allow us to say or predict how many cases there will be in the absence of any controls, and also the timing of the cases.
I think you've made it abundantly clear how important this kind of modelling work is to understanding the spread of disease. And I suppose the exposure that people had in the media to it, probably the last time I would guess, was foot and mouth, which was a rather different challenge, obviously, with different approaches, but demonstrated the requirement to use the same approach. So if we think about foot and mouth, or perhaps if we think about what you know about COVID so far, if you look back and look at what your mathematical models were predicting, say, 8 weeks ago or 12 weeks ago, has it proven to be reasonably robust?
Well, so these two quantities, the R number and the serial interval, were first estimated very early on when data were coming out of China, and they've remained pretty constant. So they're still around 3, and the serial interval still 7 to 8 days. So they've remained fairly constant. In terms of how good models are at predicting into the future, that really depends on what we understand about transmission and the processes that are important, how good the underlying data are, and how far in the future we want to predict things. So the model predictions now for next year are fairly uncertain because we don't really know what will happen. But the model predictions for next week, for example, or the next couple of weeks are pretty accurate. They do a pretty good job of predicting how many cases there'll be over the next couple of weeks. And in general, we don't tend to have one model that captures all the different things. We tend to have a model that specifically looks at care homes, or a model that specifically looks at schools and tries to understand the more local processes involved in transmission in those different settings.
Because, of course, they will be different. If you're an old person sitting in a room with a series of 20 different visitors during the day, you're likely to be completely different to an academic who's working in a lab, bumps into two people, walks home, and won't necessarily have that level of contact. Yes, and I can see that. I can see that. And there's been a reasonable amount in the media as well, and there's emerging stories, of course, in the medical press as well, about the asymptomatic spreaders, and sometimes termed things like super spreaders, which I think is perhaps a little bit unfair. And if we think back to the beginning of the outbreak, there was, of course, a notable case in the south of England where someone came back from a skiing holiday, was asymptomatic, but was traced as being the source of infection to a large number of people. Do we have a good idea of how many members of the population are, as it were, asymptomatic spreaders for that period of disease?
Well, so we're getting a better idea, although, and of course, in these models, the balance between asymptomatic, pre-symptomatic and symptomatic spread is critical for understanding how a disease spreads in the population. I mean, so early data from China suggested that a high proportion of people reported no contact with a symptomatic case. But then more recent data has perhaps suggested that even though no people didn't have contact knowingly with a symptomatic case, those cases did actually go on to become symptomatic. So there was a model that came out at the end of last month that tried to estimate the relative importance of these different routes of transmission. And they estimated that only about 6% of transmission was due to truly asymptomatic people. And then around half of the rest of transmission was due to the pre-symptomatic phase. So people don't have any symptoms and they are infectious, but they then go on to have symptoms. And then the rest of it, another half, is due to the symptomatic period. So it's this pre-symptomatic phase that seems to be really important, and the bit where you essentially miss transmission. There's also a lot of mild cases, so it appears that a high proportion of people don't have no symptoms but just have mild symptoms. It's one of the critical bits in modelling, really to understand what's going on with this virus.
I have to say, Ellen, I take my hat off to you, because you're wrestling with all these variables, some of which are unknown, and still managing to come out with data that clearly, you know, is important and influential, and has proven to indeed be accurate. Are there any other clues we can get to understanding the spread of the virus from the sort of regional variation? And I'm struck, as you know, I work in North Bristol Trust, and so I get the figures for COVID in our local area, and they're strikingly low, really, compared to other large conurbations. Clearly, London is a a mega international city, and so one might expect things to be different. But there are other cities like Birmingham, for instance, where there are many more patients. Do we have an idea of an explanation for that?
Well, I mean, interestingly, our modelling that we did back in February predicted that London would be likely to experience the first peak and the fastest initial growth rate, followed by Birmingham. And that was really because there was such a lot of connection between London and Birmingham. So we had a spatial model that and areas were connected according to commuter movements and general just travel. And Birmingham always came up as essentially straight after London. And Bristol and Cardiff were fairly well coupled, but actually were quite a lot behind the rest of the country. So in an unmitigated epidemic, even in that situation, Bristol and Cardiff were kind of 4 weeks behind London and right. Birmingham. And so it's likely that we just had the lockdown in between right. that period. Exactly. So that's why we've got a lower number of cases. But I mean, when there's lots of work going on estimating the reproduction number locally, and it looks like the reproduction number in the southwest is pretty similar to the rest of the country. In fact, at one point it seems like it might have been a bit higher, but now, I mean, it doesn't look like transmission is substantially different to other places. It's just that we've got fewer cases.
Yeah, so lockdown kind of hit the sweet spot in that respect with respect to the timing of the upsurge in cases in the southwest.
We didn't experience that big increase.
Yeah. Right. So where next for your research?
One thing that has kind of really hit home again is the importance of social contacts and understanding social contact patterns in order to understand and describe the transmission of diseases. So what I've been doing recently is looking at contact patterns from data that are 10 years old. But I've been using these contact patterns to do things, for example, like look at strategies for opening schools. So heard Boris Johnson on Sunday saying that primary schools were likely to open first. That's consistent with our analysis of the social contact data, which suggests that primary school children have fewer contacts than secondary school pupils. And so opening primary schools would have a smaller impact on the reproduction number. But there's still lots of groups we don't know much about their contact patterns. So we're about to launch a survey of University of Bristol students to understand what students' contact patterns are. I mean, we're interested in, for example, students tend to live with large numbers of people. They might have large number of contacts outside the household. And so we're interested in trying to understand what the reproduction number is in a university setting. We also want to look at contact patterns in care homes and looking at different strategies for exiting the lockdown. So how you could combine contact tracing with various physical distancing measures. But really the only way we can do those kind of predictions is by really understanding the contact patterns. So a lot of emphasis on contact patterns for my medium term work.
Excellent. Right. Well, listen, I know you're extremely busy. Ellen, it's been wonderful talking to you. Thank you so much. And good luck with all your academic activity. I mean, you've demonstrated just how important it is to all of us. Thank you very much for giving us your time.
Thanks, John. Thanks for having me on.